to the MYS Virtual Hangout. Here's your host, MYS Music Director, Raul Gomez.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to another Metropolitan Youth Symphony Virtual Hangout. It's a beautiful day outside here in Portland after several days of just kind of gloomy rain, so that feels good. You guys, we made it to 1,000 subscribers, so thank you to all of you who have subscribed in the last few days. This is, quite an accomplishment for a YouTube channel, so everybody's trying to get to that 1,000 mark, and we just got there, so thank you. And if you have not subscribed, please do it. We have a bunch of videos coming up from previous MYS performances, but also three more virtual performances from our ensembles that we're currently working on, and we look forward to releasing. Our guest today is Rachel Sokol. I'm very excited to have her. We have been, Rachel and I, in touch over email, for the last few years when she was working at Schirmer. And she was always a very, very good friend of MYS and also a really amazing advocate for composers. And now she's working with MKI Artists as an artist manager and booking agent. We're going to talk with her about her beginnings in music. She's a violinist. She played with the Oregon Symphony for a year. And she's had this amazing journey in arts administration and management. So I'm very excited to ask her all kinds of questions about that. And also, if you're watching, please remember to ask questions too. All of you Metropolitan Youth Symphony students watching and families and friends, feel free to chip in into the conversation. I'm keeping track of the comments on YouTube and Facebook. So I hope that you will have questions for Rachel. So let me go ahead. I think everything is in place, and I'm going to welcome Rachel Sokol into today's MYS Virtual Hangout. Rachel, can you hear me?
I can. Hello, awesome. Everybody.
Thank you for taking time to do this.
It's my pleasure. Anything for you and for MYS students.
Thank you. So last time I saw you in person, do you remember where we were?
I think we were in California.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yeah.
At the California Orchestra, or maybe it was in Portland. No, it was in California.
I think it was Sacramento.
Yep, it was in Sacramento, and they're talking over some recent discoveries of yours, which was really exciting.
Right, and at the time, of course, you were working with Schirmer, and also
you
were just in the middle of the whole Florence Price catalog work, right?
Yes, we were just in the midst of working on the Florence Price catalog, bringing her work to Schirmer. Actually, yes, that's right, because you were programming a piece of hers.
Yes.
For your tour, and we were trying to figure out how all the performance material would get to you in time.
What an exciting project for you and for Schirmer, right? I mean, it's a pretty important event, I think, that her catalog has become now widely available and that her music has gained so much more notoriety.
It was a very exciting moment for Schirmer as a publisher of American music historically. And I would be remiss if I didn't say that I came to learn about her. And this is also, I think, why it felt so amazing to bring her work to Schirmer. I found out about her through attending an Orchestra of St. Luke's concert that Gary Padmore, who's now at the New York Philharmonic, programmed. And he came to her work, I think, through his own research and also a woman who's really incredible named Un Lee, who does the Dream Unfinished, and she also works at Carnegie Hall. So it was even the discovery of her work in a large way was maybe emblematic of why it's so great that all of her works are now collected and accessible under one sort of publisher roof so that people can really explore the full range of her work and perform it more widely and really fall in love with it. So it was very exciting.
Yeah, and I think most MYS students who are watching this, they're familiar with Florence Price. But if there's anybody out there watching and you're not familiar with her, She is one of the great American composers of the 20th century, and her first symphony was premiered in 1932, and she has this amazing catalog of orchestral music, songs, chamber music, and it just all kind of fell into obscurity. And in the last few years, and again, Schirmer has played an important part here, her music has seen a lot more attention, and it's really exciting to see more and more orchestras and artists performing her music. In the artists that you work with, Rachel, now in your role at MKI, do you see an interest or an increase in the interest of performing music by composers of color, minorities?
Oh, absolutely. I think, you know, for all of our artists, that's always been something. And I think even with the Florence Price catalog, I think there were always people that were curious and dedicated to presenting and exploring a really wide range of repertoire. And sometimes you had to dig a lot deeper to find those sources and find out about how, you know, these people's works and their lives and how to access the actual music so that you can learn it and, you know, understand that you're working from the composer's actual edition and not necessarily a sort of cobbled together editing. So there's a lot of, sometimes there was just took that much more dedication. I mean, the same happened with Julius Eastman. You know, people, they really, if they loved his work, they found their way to it.
Yeah.
And I think the role that a publisher can play, at least in that kind of sense, is just making it that much easier for more people to find it and access it and know that it's actually, you know, what the composer intended. But yes, I mean, all of our artists are very, very dedicated to that and interested in that. And I think they're all on their own personal and artistic journeys about, you know, what voices speak to them.
Yeah. Yeah. And as I mentioned to our viewers, you are a violinist and you played with the Oregon Symphony for one season. Yes.
Yes.
And then you had this amazing journey. So I'd like to talk about that, but let's start with where you are now. So your current role at MKI, will you tell us your title and what you do currently?
Sure. So I'm an artist manager and a booking agent for MKI Artists. MKI is actually quite historical artist management company and firm founded by Melvin Kaplan, I think close to 60 years ago or more. And he left the company in 2015. And John Zion, who's now the managing director, started there years ago as an intern and took over the company a couple years ago and has really brought on a deeper range of artists. And he brought on two composers, which of course really excited me personally. And, you know, is really growing the agency into a very powerful force that represents artists of really unique virtuosity and artistry. And so my role in that is, I should say, I just started in April, so I'm still very much learning. And I guess that's one, they always be learning. But my role is to really work with concert presenters and match them with the artists that they want to present and really promote our artists and book them concert performances. Some of that is we create tours for our artists, of course. And so we try to make sure that, you know, their travel is in a certain period of time and that we're talking with presenters to, in, you know, basically the same region to kind of create a really nice and satisfying tour, both programmatically and travel wise.
Yeah.
And we also really, you know, collaborate with the artists that we represent. So there's a real desire to help them achieve their dreams and manifest what they want to manifest in their careers. Artistically, and that's a role that we play, and we represent them in kind of all of those different endeavors.
And do you work with presenters all over the world, or are you focused more in North America? Or,
well, I mean, every place does it differently, but our MKI divides up Canada, North America, in a very sort of boundary type way. So I work with presenters on the West Coast and in the Midwest and in Canada and Mexico, which is, you know, a lot of land and excitingly a lot of really interesting presenters who are super passionate and dedicated about presenting the highest level of artistry, presenting chamber music. Some of them are volunteer run organizations. Some of them are, you know, very small. Some of them are large presenters. But it's just a very exciting group of people, and it's heartening to talk to them and just hear how much it means to them to bring artists into their community and present their work.
Yeah. And some of these, of course, are orchestras. Some of these are festivals or chamber music series, right?
Absolutely.
So, well, okay. And you're in Vermont, yes?
I am.
Where are you from originally?
New Jersey.
Okay.
Not, which is very different than Vermont.
And then you spent some time on the West Coast, of course, in Portland for some time. And now you, and then with Shermer, you were in New York?
I was in New York, yep.
Okay, a little closer to home.
Yes, yes. I actually lived in Portland two times. Once in the late 90s as a violinist, and the second time as a further down my road of artistic administration in 2011 to 2014.
Yeah.
And before I came back to Portland the second time, I worked at Carnegie Hall for a number of years, which was a great privilege.
So you're, you know, bi-coastal. I mean, you've spent your entire professional career today basically going back and forth, but do you see yourself, you know, in Vermont for the foreseeable future, working in this specific field that you're in now?
Oh, yes. I mean, this shift came out of, shall we say, life journey. My husband and I were we're really thinking about our lives and the kind of day-to-day life we wanted to have and the impact we wanted to have in our various professions. He works for a software company and had some flexibility. And we were really thinking about kind of longer term. And my family is, my parents are in Massachusetts, and my sister and her family and my two nephews are also in the Boston area. And so we had a great, and my husband's family is still in New Jersey, and we had a very great desire just to kind of bring better balance to our lives and have a, you know, live in a place that affords us more ability to save and, you know, have a little more open space and nature, and being able to stay in the classical music field and work with artists and really incredible professional colleagues in such a beautiful place just kind of wasn't obvious. I think we'll do that.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds very nice. And you're mentioning spending time outside. I was about to ask if there are things about Vermont that we also have here in Portland that you enjoy, such as the outdoors.
Such as, you have wonderful hiking trails. Vermont has that in common. Vermont has actually a really incredible farm to table kind of philosophy and farmers markets. And there's a lot of small farms and food producers. Cheese is a huge deal here. Cabot, which is, you know, cheddar. I mean, I don't know. We could do a Tillamook Cabot cheese off.
Oh, but, okay.
future hangout.
There you go.
Cabot is amazing. And of course there's all these small, you know, dairy farmers that create their own special blends of goat cheese and, you know, all kinds of stuff. There's also, Ben and Jerry's is here.
Yeah.
There's a big beer. I mean, I know that NYS students are might be not old enough to enjoy adult beverages yet, but there is a really amazing craft beer scene. Although it's very New England East Coast, there is apparently an IPA philosophy that is different than the West Coast for those who are whose parents drink beer. There's a big cider tradition here. Maple, because we're so close to Canada, maple syrup and maple products are a huge producer. There's a lot of producers that this is a big industry in Vermont. And in fact, I brought this can just to show you. There is a maple seltzer brand where they literally put maple syrup sap into seltzer, and it's delicious.
It sounds like it would be. I wonder if we can find it here in Portland. I love the name. Exclamation point.
So it has that a similar, maybe a different way of expressing it, maybe because it's New England and it's a little, you know, a different kind of community, but it's has a lot of similar values, I would say, that Portland does. And there's a rich tradition of, you know, milling and all kinds of delicious food and farms. And there's a lot of sheep farms, which is exciting to me. I'm a knitter, so I love the idea of going to, you know, the spinneries and all kinds of farms where I can get, you know, special, you know, hand spun wool from those particular sheep. So it's a really, really beautiful place. There's wonderful parks and hiking here. And we have just really started to explore. So it's very cool. Exciting.
I was going to ask you about knitting, because you mentioned knitting on your Facebook post about this hangout, but I think we can talk about that later. Sure. I don't knit, but no, we'll talk about it later. I have just a couple of things to share with you about that specifically. But look, let's go back to your early years in New Jersey. So you, I imagine, you know, grew up playing the violin from a somewhat early age. Were you an early starter, or how old were you?
I was. My mom is actually a violinist also, and she was a wonderful Suzuki violin teacher. So I started when I was about 3 and a half.
Okay, yeah, super young.
Yeah, yeah. And my uncle is a wonderful jazz and klezmer pianist and clarinetist. My grandfather played some speakeasies in his youth in New York, early days. So there is a lot of music in my household. And my maternal grandfather was an amateur trumpet player. He was an engineer by day, but really loved classical music. And when I was studying piece concerti, or he had this incredible record collection. And if he knew I was studying Bruch concerto or whichever, he would comb through all of his records, and he would make me, and I still have them. I'm afraid to play them because I'm afraid it will snap, but he made me mixed cassette tapes where he would put, you know, Francescatti playing it, then Oistrakh, then, you know. So I have these incredible, and he did it all. He loved technology. He was a total early adapter. When they made laser discs, he bought like every opera on laser disc, and then laser discs stopped being something that happened. So he just had the player, and he kept watching them. But yeah, he loved going to Tower Records in Lincoln Center. And I have very distinct memories of, he would just kind of throw me in the car, and we would drive into New York City, and he would park the car, and we would go into the classical room in Tower Records and buy a bunch of, you know, vinyl or records or CDs or whatever. And so there was always a lot of love for music in my house. And so, yeah, I started playing, and I had a wonderful teacher, Nancy Clark. And she would play Fritz Kreisler records for me, which was a real, I'd never heard anything like it, to hear a violinist who also, like, I would be studying his whatever small salon piece, and then to hear him perform it in his very distinctive style was really incredible. And she was a wonderful violinist. She went to Curtis, and she actually played in her youth in an all-girl symphony orchestra in like the 1930s and 40s and toured. She was beautiful. And she had all these great stories, and she had a deaf dog and a sort of half blind cat. And we used to, she would teach me violin in her living room, and we would listen to records, and I would play music, and it was pretty amazing.
Those are such cool memories. I love the mixtape, like the cassette tape, as a gift idea. It's so cool because from such a young age, you were listening. So at MYS, you know, we talk about this with students that, you know, when you're learning a piece of music and when you're playing something with your orchestra, it's always great to seek out as many different recordings as you can of the same piece by different orchestras, different conductors, different violinists in this case. And yep. And to like start forming an opinion, you know, about what you like, what you don't like, you know, and it sounds like you were given that gift because, you know, by listening to your example, the Bruch Concerto with Franciscati and then Oistrakh, like you're already, you're learning to listen for, mm-hmm. for, you know, the different, you know, essences of the different violinists and performers. So that's...
Totally.
Do you feel like that... When you look back on that, do you think that that, in a way, started the process for you to sort of like go beyond playing an instrument and to other areas within the arts?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I never thought about it that way. I think I always, what I think it did was it helped me really make connections between things. Mm. To listen to the same piece of music played by Heifetz, by Oistrakh, by, you know, these very different violinists. Huge, sometimes range of tempo. Like I remember the first time I heard Heifetz play the Chaconne movement of the D minor partita, and it was like 10 minutes, it was so short. It would just flew by. And then later in my life as a musician where I was in college and started, like totally got fascinated by a lot of Baroque players, and really listening to Rachel Podger and Andrew Manzi and these really, Monica Huggett, who those of you in Portland will know well.
Right, she was a really, guest on the show too.
Oh, of course, that's right. Yeah, she, to listen to how they would interpret things and the phrasing and even bowing and their approach to of the music and the score was also very different. And it felt different to play and breathe in that style. I think I started to just make, maybe it was just this understanding of something had a lot of different ways of thinking about it, and that it was okay to explore and okay to make connections.
Yeah, yeah, and I mean, just that amount of listening alone as a young musician is so gratifying and so. It builds this amazing sort of foundation for, you know, your musicianship. When you were growing up, did you play with a youth orchestra or any kind of ensemble?
I did. I played with New Jersey Youth Symphony.
Nice.
They were an incredible group. Of course, like everyone, I made so many friends in youth orchestra, youth symphony. And I would say those were closer friends to me than my high school and you know, my sort of regular school. And a lot of people didn't, you know, what I was doing, spending all this time practicing and going to rehearsals at night. And that was very different to what a lot of other people, and I went to public school in Montclair, New Jersey, that they were involved in. And, but a lot of them were involved in sports too. So there were, and some visual art. So there were always people I was around that were passionate about something a little bit outside of academics and in some creative way. But yeah, youth orchestra was so much fun.
It's your tribe.
It's my tribe. And I learned a lot about rock music actually in youth orchestra. I think listening to I was very classically inundated, you know, sort of, indoctrinated, I guess. That sounds negative, but it's very positive. But my dad was a very big fan of Motown and doo-wop and, you know, real kind of pop 50s, 60s, 70s music. So classic rock. So I had a lot of different ends. And then like I went to youth orchestra and then all of my friends were listening to the rock bands and at the time grunge was very popular. And that was where I heard that music for the first time, and it was like blew my mind.
Yeah. Very cool. Do you stay in touch with any of your youth orchestra friends?
Actually, on Facebook, we are, I have friends with a couple of them, but yeah, we sort of all, you know, and in once about halfway through high school, I started being part of a pre-college program at Juilliard. So I couldn't do both. So I was doing that on the weekends. And so I kind of fell out of touch with a lot of people, which was sad to me, but we've all reconnected, a lot of them in as adults on Facebook, which has been really fun.
Yeah. Yeah. Rachel, before we continue, I think we should set up our game that we play on the MYS Virtual Hangouts, Two Truths and a Lie.
Okay.
And folks vote, see who you get to fool here. Okay. So if you're watching this for the first time and you're not familiar with the Hangouts, our guests share three statements with us. Two of them are true and one of them is a lie. And your job as the viewer is to vote for which of the statements you believe is a lie. So do you have those with you, Rachel?
I do.
Okay. All right. Let's hear statement A.
All right. Statement A. I really enjoy the sounds of most auxiliary instruments, bass clarinet, bass flute, contrabassoon, English horn.
Okay. That's up on the screen. Let's hear statement B.
Astoria, Oregon is one of my favorite places on earth.
Okay, and statement C.
I enjoy eating oysters in the summer.
Okay, all right, so those are up. I don't know which one is a lie, and let me spend a few moments here analyzing these. So your statement A is pretty specific. I also enjoy the sounds of these instruments. That'd be a, you know, an interesting thing to make up, but hey, maybe you have an aversion to them. B, Astoria, Oregon. That's also specific, and it is a beautiful place. And oysters in the summer. Okay, I love oysters too. I lived in New Orleans and Louisiana for 11 years. So pretty fresh oysters from the Gulf. And there's something, and I don't quite remember, about months that end with a certain letter. And that's when you should eat oysters. But I can't remember if that's summer months or not. So, but in any case, that's my superficial analysis of your facts. We'll let our viewers vote. So we're going to leave those up on the screen. So you went to the Hart School for violin performance.
I did.
Did you at the time... Were you already kind of attracted to other fields beyond performance?
Yes. Actually, I spent my first year of college at Goucher College in Towson, Maryland, and I was kind of trying to figure out what I wanted to do. I felt like I wanted a little distance from playing to see what else was out there and what else I was interested in, because I had spent so much of my life practicing and performing and living in that space. And I had a music scholarship there, which was wonderful. So I got to still play and perform chamber music while I was exploring a whole lot of courses. And I loved anthropology. And I took a really amazing medical anthropology class. And I remember a class about that was like team taught between with Shakespeare, a Shakespeare professor and a history professor. And it was just a kind of way of thinking about the world that I hadn't really been fully immersed in before. And I found during that year that I really missed playing. And I felt as if, you know, now was the time to really do that, if that's what I wanted to try.
Sure, sure.
As you can see, I'm a very trial by error person. So I auditioned for Hart, and at the time, the Emerson Quartet was in residence there, and I had the privilege of studying with both Mitchell Stern, who was wonderful, and Philip Setzer in the Emerson Quartet, and that was a really another incredible sort of team of thinkers and
luxury.
Emotional people that were just informed a lot.
Yeah. And you got through your bachelor's degree, and how, was your getting, you know, coming to Portland with the Oregon Symphony something that happened right away, or was there a time in between? And where was your sight set on an orchestral career?
Not necessarily. I think I just kind of was feeling out what was possible. And I spent a summer after graduating college in California. It was the first time I'd ever been to the West Coast. I really think I didn't know what to expect, but I got a scholarship to do a month-long program in Los Angeles. And who doesn't want to go to California for free and play like film music all summer? So, and I thought I would listen, you know, I started to really, I got inspired by a lot of jazz and swing musicians that a lot of studio musicians who did all kinds of different styles. And so I did that. It was called the Henry Mancini Institute. I don't know if it's still around or not, but it was a wonderful experience and I made some really amazing friends. And I really liked LA and I thought, well, why don't I give this a try? And I had a teacher as part of that festival that said, you know, if you ever move here, let me know. And so I basically was 22 and, or 21, 22, right after graduating, I was pretty open at the
Sure.
time. And I moved to LA and started freelancing. And it was really, really wild and exciting and so different than school. And the LA scene was really wonderful. And I saw an ad in the Union newspaper for Oregon Symphony auditions. And I had a really, really great orchestral excerpts teacher at Hart. And I thought, well, I should probably check this out. Oregon seems like I loved Twin Peaks. That was what I knew about the Pacific Northwest. I knew there were big trees. I'd never been there. And I thought, well, I'll go and experience an audition.
Sure. And I like trees, so I'll try
Yeah,
the
my decision making at the age of 22 was pretty simplified. And it was a cheap flight, and they had left a piece off of the repertoire list that I was terrified by. So I thought, this is the audition. This is an audition that I would feel confident taking. So I flew up and I got a number and a letter. And it was a year when a lot of musicians were leaving the orchestra, and so they accepted, I think, four or five, maybe even six members of the violin section. So it was really kind of wild, and I had no idea what to expect. And I think I wasn't putting a lot of pressure on myself, and I think that helped me to play better. My goal was just to make it past the first round, and that worked out.
And you got a job.
I did.
Do you remember? Is there anybody who's still a member of the Oregon Symphony who joined the orchestra at the same time as you did back then?
Yes. He plays tuba.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Yes.
Jatique.
Jatique and I entered the orchestra the same year.
Very cool.
And a few other musicians as well. Karen Wagner was already there for, I think, a year or two, maybe three. And who else? Robert Taylor was already there and playing with Pete Martini, actually.
And Jimmy the Priest was
Yes.
music director at the time.
Yes, he was. He was amazing.
Very cool. You mentioned jazz and swing, when you were in LA and freelancing, and you have selected a short video to share with us that is jazz swing video. So why don't we listen to that, and then we'll talk about that for a little bit.
Okay.
So, would you mind introducing this? And this will be our inaugural new segment, Show and Tell, with Rachel Sokolow.
Exciting! Yay!
So you get to be the first Hangout guest with a show and tell. So will you please tell us about what we are about to hear?
Sure, I'm very honored. So Steff Smith is a really amazing swing jazz violinist. He was a contemporary of Stefan Grappelli, Jean-Luc Ponty, who was another sort of more, I don't know, down the line jazz violinist in that tradition, was very big. Steff was a hero of his. And when I was in LA, I was learning about all these different violinists and jazz violinists and people that played with, you know, pickups and plugged in. And everyone was talking about Steff Smith and how he played a solo and he was one of the first violinists to actually plug in his instrument. And just the way that he would slide into notes and the way that he would kind of use his bow and bow speed and I don't know, he just did things very differently. And he played with some of the most incredible musicians for his entire life. But it's because he died in the 60s, it's hard to find actual video footage of him playing. He has a number of recordings that you can find, but I happened across this clip and I thought, I have to share this. It was new to me. And so I thought I wanted to show it to NYS students because it's pretty amazing. He played with Ella Fitzgerald. He played with Oscar Peterson. And in this particular clip, he really throws an incredible solo. And it's, if you imagine, you know, that coming out of a violin plugged in the 1960s on a jazz stage.
That's pretty cool.
And, you know, he moved to Denmark later in his life and passed away there.
Yeah. Okay. So let's listen. Let me get things here ready. Okay. So I will transition to the video, Rachel. And just so you know, I'm gonna mute you and I in the stream. So here we go. Everybody, enjoy. Thank you. is so cool. That's so awesome.
Isn't he amazing?
Did you ever explore improvisation or jazz or string or in your violin playing?
Not publicly. I was very shy. I did, you know, on my own, or, you know, in if I was at a party with friends, but I was very shy to do it. I was very nervous about it myself, but yeah. I just love the freedom that he has and how he's giving cues and how he's just kind of commanding the space and just owning it. And yet the compactness of his movement is just amazing to me. So yeah, I mean, for myself, I think I was more of a listener and a admirer. I never felt like I could come up with as good ideas.
it's I mean, when you hear somebody like him, just this solo that we just heard, it's storytelling. I mean, he has this amazing, you know, just technique and just the way he builds his phrases and the way he uses patterns and sequences and used to build up and all of that. But it just flows out of him. And I've always admired that in really amazing jazz players. Mm-hmm. And for MYS students who are watching, you should most definitely look him up on YouTube and check out, you know, anything you can find with him. Our last concert, Rachel, before lockdown and quarantine, was with Regina Carter, and she played David Schiff's jazz concerto called Four Sisters, and each of the movements is inspired by a leading lady of jazz, and Ella Fitzgerald is one of them. There's Billie Holiday, Sarah Vaughan, and to hear Stuff Smith performing with Ella is all these videos. I mean, that's worth anybody's time, I think.
Oh, yeah. I mean, YouTube is an amazing place if you love finding just strange performances. You can go down some incredible rabbit holes.
Yeah.
When I was working at Schirmer, one of the composers that we published was Andre Previn, who passed away not too long ago. And there's a clip of him. There's just so many clips of him playing, but there's one of him with Oscar Peterson. And, and you know, you just find these things on YouTube. Is an amazing source.
Yeah.
And every video kind of brings you to a new Wikipedia too. Sometimes you look something up and then you see a link and you go to the link, and I can spend hours that way.
Yeah, wiki surfing. That's fun.
Is that what it's called? I didn't even know that.
Unexpected places, if you do it for long enough, right?
Yes, I would say that's probably how I approach many things. I get curious and I kind of want to explore it and dive in and experience it.
And I think that's such a wonderful thing to do, to allow room for your own curiosity to lead you, you know, and to lead your exploration of things. And I mean, your own journey and, you know, into arts administration and management and in publishing is clearly, you know, at least helped in some way by this you know, endless sort of curiosity. You said always be learning. So let's talk about that transition. So you're at the end of your first season, or your season with the Oregon Symphony. What happened? How'd that go about?
I think I knew really quickly, and I just felt a real pull to expand what I was interested, just expand. I think it made me really conscious of the environment of music.
Okay.
In a way beyond just, not just, but in a way beyond performing and practicing, that there is such a big ecosystem that music exists in. And I felt like I could serve music in a bigger way, in a more impactful way. not sitting on stage and performing and being behind, not behind, I don't know, being in partnership, but knowing what it is to be on stage in that way, be working on a side of the business that can create a really positive system and ecosystem and environment and really make solutions happen and protect work and advocate for the work and the music and the composers and the musicians. I felt like, you know, I like to talk, as you can see. And that really energizes me. So I felt like, I don't know, I just had this sort of moment of awakening for myself and really feeling that that was something that would mean something to me.
Yeah. And you
but were... I loved playing. I mean, I loved playing with that. The orchestra is wonderful, and there's just some amazing people there that I met and still I'm in touch with.
Yeah, it's a great organization, and of course we're all, you know, crossing our fingers and hoping for the best so that our orchestras can be on stage as soon as possible. You worked with Columbia Artist Management towards the the beginning of your journey.
Yes.
Was that your
You've done your research.
Yeah. Well, you know, I Google my guests.
That was my very first, and I guess it's coming full circle now. That was my very first job in New York in the arts, not as a performer.
Yeah.
It was an incredible place to be for a brief period.
Do you find yourself applying lessons that you learned back then and what you're doing now?
Well, I will say when I was working with them, there wasn't really the internet.
Oh, okay.
It was, I think 2000. Yeah, maybe the internet was, it was like 2003. It was very, very early days.
Sure. Certainly not what it is today.
No, there was no Facebook.
Right.
There wasn't even YouTube. There was not even a really good MapQuest or anything like that. So doing itineraries for artists was, we had a travel agent. You had to call the person and say, I want a flight. I need a flight because this cellist, they need this many tickets. And they need. What I learned was really how to communicate with people and how to solve problems quickly. And I really learned how to use a fax machine. We used fax machines because artists would be traveling in Taiwan or Europe and they didn't have a cell phone.
Yeah.
So that was how you got a hold of them. You faxed them a letter to say, please call the office.
A lot has changed in 18 years or so. You spent quite a bit of time at Carnegie Hall.
I did.
How long were you there?
A little over 7 years.
Okay. And did you have several different roles in that time, or were you doing... Can you share with us about your time there?
Sure. When I started there, I was working for a program called Link Up. And you probably know it well. I think the Oregon Symphony might even be a partner, where it's an elementary education program and students learn classical phrases from certain pieces on recorder, or they sing it, or there's different units, and they come to the hall every spring and they get to play with the orchestra on stage and the sound of 2,800 recorders will never leave you.
Those are super, I think those are so fun. I've done a few
in a fun way. Yeah.
And I really enjoy them. But it's a wonderful program, and you know, it gets kids playing and, you know, exposed to music, and orchestras work with the school teachers. It's such a cool thing.
It was an amazing program, and the Carnegie had just gotten a grant to take it outside of New York City. And so I got to be on the team that helped kind of build initial satellite locations, which was really fun because I got to work with Omaha Symphony and the Honolulu Symphony, and just all these great orchestras that just really had wonderful teachers that they could engage, and it gave them an opportunity to build those relationships, which was really, really fun. And then after a couple of years working with that program, there's a program that's now called Ensemble Connect that Clive Gillinson and Joseph Felici, who was the head of Juilliard at the time, and the Department of Education in New York City, and all of these incredible institutions came together and decided that they wanted to work with postgraduate musicians in a small setting and kind of give them access to professional development and interactive concerts, teach them how to have an in-depth residency and relationship in a New York City public school in partnership with a teacher, and also perform as in various ensembles throughout 2 years on stage at Carnegie Hall. It was an incredible program, and it started with a number of musicians and kind of launched very quickly, and we really learned how to kind of work on the fly, and it was an incredible team. Amy Rhodes is the director of that program, and yeah, we all, and to see many of these musicians that were in the initial classes that I worked with, they've now founded their own organizations and festivals, and they're playing all over the world, and they came to that program with wanting to have a different kind of career, and they take that kind of energy with them, and it's really inspiring.
Yeah, and I mean, all of these things you've done over the years, it's, you know, I feel like they complement each other so well, and there must be so much learning in each one of them. After Carnegie Hall, you find yourself back on the West Coast, and you know, you worked with Woodstock, you worked with PYP, the Portland Youth Philharmonic, for some time. Okay. Music at Menlo with David Finkel and
Wuhan.
Yes, and Wuhan, and you know, all kinds of fun things that we would need a full hour just to get through all of them. Let's fast forward to
We can fast forward
to MKI again. We have a question from a viewer, and it's the following: what are you and other MKI agents encouraging your musicians to do with the copious amounts of alone time the pandemic has given us?
Wow, who asked that question? I wanna know, I wanna talk to this person. I think there's a couple ways of answering it. I would say, you know, John Zion, our managing director, works very closely with all of our artists. And I think this is an area where relationships are so important, and trust is so important. This is no one's ever been through this before. So we're all experiencing this together for the first time. We all have different challenges and responses to this kind of event. Everybody is scared of in some way, and that comes out in its own way. And everybody feels energized by the creativity.
Yes.
Also, and so, you know, it's really about staying in communication and making sure that everybody knows that we're here to support them and try to give them and work with them on new ideas, new ways to perform and deliver what they can deliver. Trying to find opportunities to connect presenters who are trying to pivot into a virtual space with an artist. I think that's something we've really been doing a lot of talking, a lot of brainstorming, a lot of, you know, coming up with ideas together about what makes sense and what an artist can do. And many, all of the artists have families or people that they are related, you know, thinking very, very carefully about when a quartet will come back together and what what rules might exist, what they might need to set up for themselves to feel healthy and safe in getting back to rehearsal. So it's all about just kind of being honest and open and communicating together and being honest about how you're feeling. And that there's no pressure.
What a time to navigate as an artist agency. And like you're saying, all of these relationships that you have with these artists come, you know, front and center, and you have these conversations with each one of them. And it's, of course, we're excited to see a gradual return to some kind of normality when it comes to live performances, which of course needs to be done very cautiously. And like you mentioned, you know, small percenters, chamber music series, and, you know, it's, we just hope that everything keeps moving in the right direction for everybody. Rachel, we're just about to run out of time. So there are a couple of things we need to do before we let you go. And the first one is we have to reveal your truths and lie.
Oh, right. Okay.
So we're going to go back to that. So they're up on the screen again. So if you didn't get to vote, you have a few more seconds to do it. I'm going to read Rachel's statements real quick, and then we will reveal the a truth, and then another truth, and then the lie. So statement A is Rachel really enjoys the sounds of most auxiliary instruments like bass, clarinet, bass, flute, contrabassoon, English horn. Statement B, Astoria, Oregon is one of Rachel's favorite places on earth. Statement C, Rachel enjoys eating oysters in the summer. Okay, so let me guess first. I'm going to vote, and I'm going to say that C is your lie, only because I'm not sure about the summer part of this. So, but let's go ahead and let's reveal your first truth.
My first truth is that Astoria, Oregon is one of my favorite places on earth.
Nice. Okay. When's the last time you've been there?
The last time I was there was, I think it was like 2 summers ago.
Yeah.
My husband and I were visiting our Portland friends. And whenever we're in Portland, we take a couple, we rent a car and take a couple days and go to the coast.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think it's, we're well overdue.
Yeah. I hope that you guys get to come back soon. What's your final truth? And therefore we will be also revealing the lie.
I do love auxiliary instruments.
Nice.
Sitting in the violin section, you would hear these, you know, you would see everybody in the wind section rustling around getting a different size thing. And it just, you know, it was always very exciting.
Very good. I also happen to love the sounds of, well, you said Moos. Is there one that you don't like?
Oh, I don't love the really, I'm going to get in trouble for this. What is it? Is it the E-flat clarinet? The very kind of.
Sure. Yeah.
That one. There's a couple really, really strident solos, I feel like in Shostakovich or such, it's effective, but
it's piercing, you know. Well, you know,
it does its job.
Yeah, right.
It lives up to expectation, but given a choice, I would much rather hear a bass clarinet or an English horn.
And finally,
high clarinets.
I'm sure they understand. And I'm sure some clarinet players agree with you anyways, right? Okay, so now oysters, do you not like them, or what's the deal with that statement?
I have a very difficult relationship with oysters.
Oh, is that right?
Okay. I actually don't know when is the good season to eat them. I just thought that would, I was trying to pick a lie that wasn't so obvious that everybody would just immediately get it. I have a very mixed feeling about oysters. Sometimes they're the best thing on earth, but not that often for me.
Yeah. And well, you know, there are so many different kinds, and just, they have to be fresh. They have to be right. You know, it's a very specific thing, and it's also an acquired taste. The summer part was what I was not so sure about. And I think Oyster season in Louisiana, I think it's the months that end with an R that you that is oyster season. Please somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but it's been a while since I've eaten oysters anyways. Okay, so there you go. C is the lie, and we have at least one viewer who got that right, William Graham, one of our bass players.
Bravo.
Okay, cool. And finally, Rachel, the last thing that I would like to ask you is if you have anything to plug or to share with people you want to bring attention to, whether it's online or any kind of event, then this is a time to do that.
I don't know that I have anything very specific to plug, but just kind of keep practicing, keep exploring, keep playing. Keep talking to other artists and listening to what they're practicing and playing and who inspires them. And, keep learning, keep being curious.
Very nice. And I think that's one of the things that I take away from this time that I just spent with you is just to, be curious and just seek out what you're passionate about and trust the journey. So thank you for spending time with us. I hope,
Thank you for having me and inviting me. It was
yeah, I
really
hope
fun.
the rest of your summer in beautiful Vermont continues to be very enjoyable and that things continue to move in the right direction for you and your colleagues at the agency and also all of the artists that you guys work with. So thank you again. I look forward to staying in touch and talking about how things continue to evolve. So
Me too.
Rachel, thank you again. You've been such an amazing guest. I've thoroughly enjoyed our conversation and thank you everybody for watching. So
Thank you, everybody. This was my first time doing a Zoom live interview. So thank you, Raul, for making and NYS for making it so seamless and just really fun and enjoyable. And it was really nice to talk together
Well,
today.
thank you so much. It was very enjoyable. So, we'll let you go now. See you later.
Bye.
And as always, thank you for watching. We have another amazing guest this week on Thursday, 2 days from today at 4 p.m. Jun Iwasaki, the current concertmaster of the Nashville Symphony, will be our guest. He was also the concertmaster of the Oregon Symphony not too long ago. The next week, Thursday, June 25th, Valdin Mishkin, an amazing Portland cellist and teacher, will be our guest in the Hangout, and I cannot wait to talk to both of them. So, thank you again for watching. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. We made it to 1,000 subscribers, but we look forward to sharing what we have to offer with even more people. That includes more Hangouts, but also a bunch of videos coming up of previous MOS performances, as well as virtual performances that we're currently putting together. So, thank you again. Stay healthy, stay safe. See you next time.